Scientific Imagination is part of the future-based platform. For more information, visit scientificimagination.org. Analogue Astronauts is something that I got acquainted with only very recently, and basically entails that astronauts are going on space mission while staying here on Earth. They do research, tests and experiments in special built domes and only go outside in full astronomic gear. This sounds really fun and exciting, but it's also very serious business because it helps us imagine the possibilities on living on Moon and Mars and doing research in space. My guests in this podcast are Sabrina Kerber and Charlotte Pouwels, two very experienced analogue astronauts. Sabrina Kerber is an engineer, space architect and analogue astronaut from Austria. Sabrina has collected valuable experience in the space sector by working in the United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs and with the International Lunar Exploration Working Group EuroMoonMars. In 2019, Sabrina was part of the lunar simulation and renowned high seas habitat, where she acted as a crew engineer. As founder and CEO of Explanata Space Solutions, Sabrina is working on leveraging the benefits of additive manufacturing for extraterrestrial habitation. Sabrina is also one of the organizers of the Chill Ice Analogue Mission, where she acts as a habitation specialist and crew system engineer. In her free time, my second guest is Charlotte Pouwels. Charlotte is a physicist from the Netherlands with a specialization in radiation and cube satellites. She works as an analogue astronaut and co-mission organizer for the Chill Ice EuroMoonMars mission. She participated in a 2 week high seas analogue habitat for human spaceflight to Moon Mars in 2019. Charlotte is the head of logistics and co-organizer for the Chill Ice mission in 2021, where they will construct a habitat inside a lava tube on Iceland for lunar simulation missions. Next to her work for EuroMoonMars, Charlotte is also a full-time test engineer at Airbus Defence and Space Netherlands, diver, wanderer, traveler and entrepreneur. Yes, but you are doing many, many interesting things. So I'm really, really happy to have you on this podcast for Scientific Imagination. First of all, welcome Charlotte and Sabrina.
Great, thanks for having us tonight.
It's very exciting.
Could you both please give an introduction of your background and your current occupation?
I'm a physicist from the Netherlands. I live near Delft. I have a specialization in radiation, cosmic radiation and cube satellites, and then the focus on thrusters, so propulsion systems for cube satellites. I work full-time at Airbus Defence and Space in the Netherlands as a solar panel test engineer. So we test there all the solar panels before they go into space, before they are connected to the satellite. Furthermore, I'm a diver in my free time, a traveler, and currently trying to set up some businesses. I know Sabrina via EuroMoonMars as work there both as analogue astronaut.
And we will dive into that topic a little bit later. Sabrina, could you elaborate on your occupation?
Yeah, sure. So I'm a space architect, an analogue astronaut, and the CEO of a startup called Explanata Space Solutions. So basically, I'm an engineer who's mainly dealing with how we will in the future live on Moon or even on the Mars. This involves coming up with new concepts and designs, understanding the technical and physical parameters we need for this, but also field testing prototypes and scenarios in simulations as an analogue astronaut. So at Explanata Space Solutions, we're dedicated to developing smart solutions to improve habitability aspects on long-duration space missions. So this could be items or designs for living on the Moon or on Mars, but also on space stations or long-duration space travel. And the focus hereby lies in the field of additive manufacturing and deployable technologies, and all for human exploration. And we're also kind of trying to maintain really high standards of sustainability. So that's something that's really important to me personally.
You both are very passionate about your jobs. What was your biggest motivation to follow this path throughout your career?
So I've kind of always been really fascinated with space exploration. I think like many of us, I grew up on watching Stargate and Star Trek and all those 90s sci-fi series. And I always wondered which of these scenarios we could really make happen and what we would need to do for that. So being able to travel through space is one thing, but actually being able to live there on a long-term basis is an even greater challenge. And it really fascinated me. And I still feel like space exploration is the largest adventure of our time. And I'm just super excited to be a part of this.
And how did you get to to know each other?
So we both participated in EuroMoonMars High Seas mission, which is the Hawaii analog exploration and simulation on Mauna Loa near Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
And they perform analog astronauts missions there to see how it is to live on Mars or on the moon. And what are the aspects that we need to investigate for this? Like, what are the human boundaries, the mental aspects, the physiological aspects, but also how to perform research, etc. And I got to know Sabrina via this mission. We were in the same team, the MS-2 mission, which was last year, December 2019. And it was very exciting to being locked up for 2 weeks with limited amount of water. You were only able to shower for 7 minutes a week. So a lot of cold showers, at least.
Mm.
And we had dry-freeze food. So our hygiene and our body needed to adjust to this. Also, sleep was quite difficult and a lot of more aspects. But it was really an exciting and great mission to see how it is to live on Mars or on the moon.
Indeed. Conditions we got to know each other really on a very personal basis really fast, so it's a very interesting way to actually meet someone you haven't really met before.
I can imagine.
Yeah, he had almost no privacy, and that was also one of Sabrina's tests or researches, is how privacy involves the human body, the human mental aspect, which was quite exciting.
And this was part of the EuroMoonMars program. Could you explain what this program entails?
So EuroMoonMars is founded and funded by the International Lunar Exploration Working Group, which again itself is funded by space agencies like ESA or NASA. So we actually get a tremendous amount of support from them, using ESA's ESTEC facility kind of as a headquarter and having training there. So with EuroMoonMars, we are working researching with the goal of making a permanent settlement on the moon and then eventually on Mars a reality. Of course, this is a really big endeavor, and to make it happen, we need a really diverse and dedicated team. So we have international members from really diverse backgrounds within different fields of space science, but not only on the engineering and science side. We also have a lot of artists. We have sociologists, psychologists. So it's a really diverse team, actually. And with this team, we're doing events each year. So this means like doing workshops, doing field campaigns, doing missions at, for example, large and well-known stations like Charlotte mentioned, at High Seas or at MDRS in the USA.
But it's quite nice because you meet so many interesting people that are passionate about space, and you work in international context with people from Brazil, from Canada, from India, from North Korea. So you meet all those people all over the world with the same passion, which makes it all more exciting. And they also provide you with more opportunities for research, funding, grants,
Exactly.
Other applications.
Yes. Yeah. Speaking about opportunities, there is a new analog mission coming up, right?
So the CHILLISE mission is coming up. It will be hosted in Iceland this year around the end of May, beginning of June. And this mission has a kind of different approach than the normal or the regular analog astronaut missions that people hear about. Most missions are focused that you lock a team up of six or crew of six. And you lock them up for 2 weeks, up to 3 months, up to 6 months. And you see how they react on this different environment and how they cooperate with each other. Our mission focuses actually on the first steps on the moon, like when we just got there and you have all those lava tubes there for you available, and there's like kind of an emergency and the astronauts need to get out and do an EVA. They will have around 8 hours of air during that EVA, and they will need to set up an emergency habitat, and for protection of radiation and micro meteorites, they can use the lava tube. So what we will investigate is if a crew of three analog astronauts can set up a habitat in just 8 hours inside the lava tube, which is quite difficult while they're wearing all the gear, the suits, getting all the materials inside. So it's quite a great endeavor, and we're working with a really good team on this. We have all international partners who are collaborating on research or providing materials. It will be quite exciting, and if they want to follow EuroMoonMars or the mission itself, they can follow us of course on LinkedIn or Facebook or on Instagram.
Yeah, I will make sure that there are links on the website.
Okay.
And it sounds very, very exciting, and I can imagination plays a great big deal in this kind of analog endeavors. Could you explain, both of you, maybe what role imagination plays in this kind of projects?
Yeah, well, It obviously plays really important role for any analog mission, not only for chill ice, because no matter how well we simulate technical backgrounds, for example, a simulation can only work kind of with a certain amount of imagination. So you need to be really able to convince yourself that you're in the situation that you're simulating. You kind of have to get into the right mindset. And of course, we use all the preparation we do, the technical simulations to make this happen. But in the end, it's really dependent on the analog astronauts and actually the whole mission team to really get into the mindset of, okay, they're on the moon now, they're doing this mission, and you can't just take off your helmet because on the moon you would die. So you don't do it in the mission, even if you get like super hot and it's getting hard to breathe. We're trying not to kind of cheat. So I think this is the most important part that imagination plays for this.
Yeah, so it's all about visualization and like one main big thought experiment, the whole simulation.
Yeah, that's interesting, because how is it a thought experiment? Could you explain what the structure of this thought experiment is?
So from the moment you will get dropped off by your rocket and you will be on the moon or on Mars, depending on your simulation, the whole crew imagines that it's actually living on Mars and it's actually living on moon. So with everything you do, you have to take into consideration that help is far away, can't access mission control, you don't have internet, you don't have all these luxuries that we have here. So you have to think twice with everything you do and make sure that you stay in the Mars or in the moon vibe.
And speaking about imagination, Sabrina, you just finished your master with a thesis called Heaven, Lunar Port and Base. Could you elaborate on your thesis?
Yeah, of course. So for my master thesis, I had to design a lunar settlement, as well as the whole mission around it. So I pretty much had to imagine the whole thing from start. So the thesis was called Haven, Lunar Port and Base, and it was the design for an arrival port on the moon with a long-term habitat for a crew of 8. So for me, this included, of course, designing the habitat itself. It was probably like the main part of it, making sure all the physical and all the technical parameters are met. So for example, is it safe for humans to live there? So inside the habitat, is it shielded from radiation and micrometeoroids? How do we handle waste and life support? How will it be constructed? What robotic support equipment do we need to deploy and maintain the habitat? But it also meant figuring out how we would launch the whole habitat to the moon in the first place. It also involved deliberations on how to make the concept as sustainable as possible, so both for the environment on Earth and on the moon.
How do you decide when to apply imagination? Is this a very conscious process?
No, it's actually not very conscious. And I think it's all about finding the right balance, and it's something that should happen naturally. So yeah, if I had to pin it down in percentage, I would want to say like you need 100% imagination and also 100% awareness of all the technical stuff, because one cannot work without the other. If I'm not able to imagine the concept, I'm not designing a concept, we're not going anywhere. But if I'm not aware of all of the technical challenges, it's not going to work in the end. It's going to be maybe a nice sci-fi project.
Yeah, I think it's imagination is next to you while you're writing or doing research. It's the path that it shows the path that you have to follow, because if you're not able to imagine where you want to go, you don't know where to go. Like your imagination in your head, your dreamer part that's inside of everyone, it shows you where to go, what the requirements are, and then with the technical aspects, with physics, math, psychology, you will fill in the gaps. Imagination shows you the way where to go and how you get there, and then you will see to find the requirements for yourself with the technical base, of course.
Is imagination a very big innovation accelerator, for example?
Yeah, I would say so, yes.
In what way?
So, for example, the idea of going to the moon or to Mars is already imagination at itself. Like it started around 1930 or something, that they wanted to start everything. And then you had, of course, the Cold War, when they were focusing really a lot on getting to the moon and to Mars. That was all coming from imagination and, of course, political issues. Like imagination shows that we want to innovate. When we want to innovate, we make our goals and our dreams realistic with the technical base. It goes hand in hand, and I think imagination is on the base of everything that we want to do and going forward. For example, if I imagine now that I live on Jupiter or on Pluto, and don't say it's going to happen in the next 50 years or so, but if I'm imagining it, and then not only I am imagining it, but Sabrina is imagining in it, you are imagining it, and for example, 10,000 of people are imagining it. If you have the same people who have the same imagination and get the same ideas, then with innovation, we come forward and we start making it realistic. And I think that's also where Star Trek was based on, just getting the idea out of there and getting it in the minds of people. And then they start thinking about it and then they start working to make it realistic.
Now we're talking about some kind of collective imagination that pushes innovation. There are a lot of innovations in Star Trek, for example, that are now very much reality. You say that if we collectively imagine innovations and putting it in films, for example, displaying it in films, that there is some self-fulfilling prophecy that we work towards this imagination because it's materializing in films.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely what's happening right now. Of course, with some limitation of to what is actually possible. But for example, in space architecture, in movies, one thing you always see is a big lunar settlement with huge domes across them. So this is at the moment quite unrealistic. So when we plan habitats, we're going for small habitats that each have their own protection, and the habitat itself is the protection. We wouldn't make like one big dome over like a whole city on the moon, but it is still something that everyone is thinking about. Whenever you mention space architecture, that's what people imagine in the very beginning. And it's also a reason why we're still working towards this. And of course, it's an ideal because we've seen it in films and we've read about it in books, and it's very much rooted in our minds because of this collective imagination. And I don't think it's something that we would be working toward with that much effort if it wasn't that present in our minds.
So imagination is this guide to possibilities in this perspective, right? Could imagination be constrained enough by using background information, by using data to make claims about reality?
Yeah, I think that if you have your imagination, if you have your idea, then you look it over with your background, of course, with maybe physics, with mathematics, with data analytics, or even architecture. You look at your foundation, your mechanical base, and then you see, okay, I have this idea, I have this imagination. It's now, at the moment, it's still a fantasy, but I want to make it more realistic. So to make this real, what are the requirements? What are the limits that I'm walking against to? And how do I make this happen? That's mainly the process of how everything actually goes in engineering, at least in my perspective and from my side. We first have an idea, and then to make it realistic, we look it over with all the realistic requirements, such as your base. See if it's possible to make with physics or with mechanical engineering, for example. And if it's not possible, then you're imagining a different part. You're looking, okay, I have to focus on this. How could I make this more realistic, and how can we solve this problem? Then your imagination steps in again. You look at different options, and then you repeat the process, actually. So it's a loop. You're going into the loop every time. It's imagination, making it realistic. Is it not possible? Imagination again, making realistic again. And that's how you go through the whole process. It's moving alongside. It's not like you can have space exploration without art, or you can't have, for example, your phone. This was imagination, and then it became realistic. Like, you can't have the one without the other. They're like next to each other.
So, and in this sense, you say that imagination also can make claims about reality.
Yes, it's your own mind that is the limit in imagination.
Sabrina, do you have anything to add?
No, I actually think Charlotte said it really well. Yeah, if you don't constrain imagination in some way, you're going to end up with very unscientific results. But if you don't use imagination at all, you're probably going to have nothing. So yeah, you need both of things, and you need to have them working together in a good balance or a loop. Of course, analog missions are a crucial step in that direction, because they give us at least some manner of testing or prototyping these imaginations or projects that we're working on.
And what will be the effect on increased accessibility then to space on your field of research?
Oh, so much.
Tell me.
So I think the broader the access to space is going to be, the more benefits we will be able to leverage from it. So I'm not only speaking from space architecture perspective, but in general, I think we will progress so much faster with more access to space if more people are involved, if more disciplines are involved. I'm also very excited about, for example, having a more diverse access to space. So having a better gender balance, maybe. I think this is going to make a big difference. So at the moment, space is quite limited to a certain group of people, but I think we will all benefit from having more countries involving, a better gender distribution. And this is already happening at the moment. So it's a slow process, but it's a constant process. And I think we can already see the changes in the last couple of years.
But it's not only space exploration that has advantage of this process or gaining more access. With all these new technologies, Earth itself, we will have access to more technologies. For example, healthcare, logistic products, like medicine, for example, all these technologies that are developed for space, they can also be used, of course, on Earth. Also, when we have access to other planets, we have more materials, we can do more research, we can get a better understanding of how we got here, who we are. Like, all those big questions are, you can find that in space. So having more access to space is a huge deal to us.
Yes.
And for Earth itself.
Yes, because that's a good point, because I spoke with Nancy Vermeulen, who stated the same, actually. What do you think about the commercial developments around SpaceX, for example?
Yeah, you kind of have to defer, because on the one hand, it's super exciting, especially for people like Charlotte and me. It might give us a much better chance to actually get into space. And I think we can both agree that we're super excited about that. But I would also want to make sure that this doesn't end in some form of very unsustainable, maybe, space tourism, because obviously a lot of money can be made with space and with exploiting space. And I think there are definitely those people who would exploit it without thinking about the future. And we've already done this to Earth. So I think before we send out all of humanity, let's just make sure we all have the right mindset to actually go there and not destroy the environment out there.
And that's, I'm not sure, Sabina, if you've heard of it before, but that's why there's a master space law. One of our crewmates, Anna Castro from Brazil, she actually did this master space law, and they are trying to set up a bunch of rules actually that applies to everybody that's working in space. So not only ESA, NASA, etc., but also the commercial companies such as SpaceX. They will have their limits because they are bound to the space laws. One of the things that is mainly important in space law, for example, is that you cannot buy a piece of a planet. For example, you cannot buy a part of the moon. And for example, if SpaceX is opening a hotel on the moon, they cannot buy that piece of ground. It's not of them. It's for everybody.
I think this is very exciting, because I think this asks for such a different mindset than we have here on Earth, where every little piece of land is all very much framed. And this asks of something very different, a very different kind of economics, a very different kind of ethics, but also mindset in general. Nancy Vermeulen, when she was the commander of the space simulating project in Utah, and when she was standing out there in the desert and she looked up to the starry sky, starry night, she really could imagine being on Mars. And then she said, "I was wondering what it would be like to see this tiny, tiny blue speck that then would be the Earth." My question to you is, did you experience a same sort of situation during your analog mission?
Yeah, and I think that's one of the signs that the mission is being done right. Mm. So as we already mentioned, one of the main things you do is try to make everything as realistic as it's possible. So at high seas, the environment is very much like being on Mars or on the moon. So not only the habitat, but also the geology around the habitat. So when you're going out there, you're standing out there completely isolated from the rest of the world. You can't see any other people. You can't hear any cars. All you can see around you is this rock. And it really feels, you're also wearing this heavy EVA suit. You can't breathe really well. You're really in this mindset, and suddenly it really feels like you're on the moon. And I think once you have reached that point, you're really you've really started to be on the mission. So it's a really crucial step for the whole mission. Yeah,
it is just amazing. We had an EVA where we will look out at the stars, and at some point we were just starting to lay down on the rocks and look up at the stars, and we were just wondering indeed how would it be, and that we were actually now on the moon, for example. And it was just unbelievable. But on the other side, it is quite difficult we really don't need to underestimate it. For example, the breathing, it can be really hard because when you're on an EVA for 2 to 3 hours and you have limited oxygen and limited access to air, and then you come back to your habitat, you're all sweaty. And yeah, it takes a lot of your mental aspect, but also of your body. And we really don't need to forget that when we send people over there, because if you're overestimate ourselves, then things can go wrong really easily. Yeah, and this, of course, like when something goes wrong in the space sector, the whole Earth will know about it. And then people are afraid really easily. And they just say like, oh, no, we're not going to the moon or Mars again. So we really need to make sure that everything happens in a safe way, in a positive way, in a positive vibe, so we get everybody aboard to the same goal.
Yes. What is the goal, actually?
Well, I think humanity, as humans, we are explorers. So pretty much the same as hundreds of years ago when you were living in your small part of the country. But there was always someone who felt the need to go further, to explore, maybe, yes, to make other lands your own. But I think the bigger motivation is just is a really big fascination with going somewhere where you haven't been before, where you don't know what it looks like. I think this is kind of the key point in the space sector. Everyone is super passionate about space. It's really amazing, actually. I've never met anyone in the space sector who does this job just because it's a job and it gets some food on your table. We're all a bit crazy about space and about going out there and discovering what's out there. And just sending a rover up to the moon and getting pictures is super exciting, but it's not going to be enough, because once you have the pictures, you actually want to get some, maybe some rock samples, and then you want to go there and actually walk around there. And yeah, I think it's this immense passion that everybody brings to the table that's actually making stuff happen.
It's not only for space, it's in our nature, and we can't really work against it. I think we are natural born explorers, as Sabrina already said, and there is no ending to it. Like when we have a human settlement on the moon or Mars, of course we will continue. Like we won't stop. I'm reading a book right now, it's called Artemis, and there are also some other books that are going that there's like a habitat on Mars, a habitat on the moon, and a habitat of, yeah, you have Earth yourself and you have the ISS station. And they are in war with each other. And this is like 200-300 years in the future, because the people from Mars, they want to go to Earth, but the people who are born on Mars and who are born on the moon, they really can't go back to Earth if they are born there because of gravity. Like gravity will crush their organs, for example. And there is a risk when we get to Mars and get to the moon that we are not thinking of clearly about 300 to 400 years, but we don't know what's going to happen then. We just have to make sure we make the right decisions along the along its way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course we need to be really cautious about what we do, and it's good that there are groups of people who are really trying to make this happen, that we're really cautious and mindful of what we do, but still saying we're not doing it because we're afraid of messing it up. I don't think that's a good argument, and it's definitely gonna stop us from doing good things. And we just have to try to learn from history and prevent the bad things from happening, and yes, then try to like go forward.
Yes, as a philosopher, it's very easy to ask critical questions, or easy. I think it's important. And at the same time, I really do feel the excitement, the wonderment, and your passion for this whole project. And what really strikes me is that for both of you, storytelling is very important. So for example, Sabrina, you mentioned Star Trek. Charlotte, you mentioned your books you're reading. So this also really sparked your imagination, I think. Could you please, because we are almost at the end of the podcast, tell me or inspire me with the books you are reading?
Oh, there's so many. Yeah. Do you have pen and paper?
Or? Yes, absolutely. I'm recording this, so I'll be fine.
Okay. Now, of course, you have Artemis, which is some kind of like The Martian. And it's a really, it's a realistic book, actually. It's kind of fantasy. There are some fantasy parts, of course, like the main character is, it's all fantasy. But all the things that are happening around it, how we are imagining it, how it would be there.
And it was actually written by Andy Weir, who's also the author of The Martian. And what's really cool about him, so I can also recommend The Martian, but I agree that Artemis is even better. Like I absolutely loved that one. What's really cool about Andy Weir is that he's doing really extensive research on the space habitats. So he's actually working together with space architects and people from NASA to really make it as realistic as possible. So if you want to like know about space habitats, it's super easy to read either The Martian or Artemis and just kind of learn on the go in a very easy storytelling way. I can also absolutely recommend the book series to the expanse. It's actually, the first one is called Leviathan Wakes. So it goes like much more into detail than the series does. And it's also based on a lot of very realistic principles. Like, for example, when they travel through space, a lot of sci-fi series, they kind of negate the time that it actually takes to travel, for example. And so this series really takes this into account. And they're also based on like really realistic research. So I can really recommend reading that series. You actually want to like hear something more like something actually realistic, I can really recommend The Diary of a Cosmonaut, 211 Days in Space. That's probably my favorite one, or my favorite like non-fiction book. It's actually the diary of Soviet cosmonaut who's going to a space station, and it's super interesting because it also touches on what's happening back on Earth. So there are letters included that he's writing to his wife, and yeah, it gives you a really like interesting sense of how space exploration used to be in kind of in comparison to how it is now on the ISS.
And you have the Natural Geographic series, not sure if you've seen it. It's the real right stuff about how the first astronauts actually were selected, the process that they went through. You see how all their thinking and how the politics and how the ethics are all involved in choosing the astronauts and getting them to space, and actually the idea of imagination of getting there, combined with the Cold War, of course, because they were going against Russia.
Wonderful. But
there are like so many things on space. And I think if artists or book writers or authors, they want to write about something and they want to spark their imagination, mostly they write about space, because that is, of course, the ultimate imagination goal.
I agree with you. And I will make sure everything, all the books and the links are in the on the website. And I want to know, where can we find you on the internet, somewhere in space?
Yeah, so first of all, I think Charlotte already mentioned it. You can follow EuroMoonMars on all of the social media platforms like LinkedIn, Facebook. We also have a open Facebook group that is called Space Moon Mars, and it's free for everyone to join and ask questions, participate in discussions. It's kind of like an open forum for space enthusiasts. You can also follow EuroMoonMars on Instagram. So I think this is like the first address to go if you want to like know about the project or upcoming missions. And then for me personally, you can just follow, like connect with me on LinkedIn. That's I'm really active on that platform. And you can follow me on Instagram under the at @xplaneta.
And another thing is, we have a space pub quiz with international space teams from all over the world, from Canada, from Poland. They're teams from everywhere who are enthusiastic about space, and they're just space nerdy questions. And it's not only science.
That's nice. Do you have more often this kind of quizzes?
That's actually the first quiz that we're having, but we're quite frequently doing events like online workshops, especially now with the whole quarantining situation. And this is always like, we're always super excited for kind of like non-scientists to join those workshops and present their work and how it relates to space. So I think we're happy to invite everybody who wants to join in and maybe apply for a workshop like that.
Yeah, well, I will make sure to share your links. And I'm very interested in your work. Thank you. Thank you so much for joining this podcast.
Yeah, thank you for your time, Sabina, and inviting us. It was really exciting and really awesome to think about space in this way. Like, we were so focused on the science and the engineering and just making it work that we forget about, how do we got here, actually? And how are we making the decisions that we make on a daily basis for the space sector or for these projects? And that's because of our passion, our dreams, our imagination, our fantasy.
Yeah, thanks for having us. It was a pleasure to be here. And I think you gave us a lot to think about. And I don't know, I hope we gave you some answers, but also some new things to think about.
Yes, certainly. Thank you. For more information, show notes and links, visit scientificimagination.org. In the next podcast, I will talk to Samantha Copeland, founder of the Serendipity Foundation. In this podcast, we will explore the similarities and differences between the function and role of imagination and serendipity in science.